Basically, when I began to write on the rise of China, I want to explain this fact to the Chinese within China, to the outside world. And it's important, you know, to see there is so much misunderstanding about China, about the rise of China, and even about basic facts. So I said, let's do something to tell the truth, at least how most Chinese see China as it is. And the rise of China is indeed very important. It's not just an ordinary country. I always say that China is a civilizational state, which means it's the world's longest continuous civilization. Amalgamated with a super large modern state. You treat China as if it were made up of hundreds of states into one, with its long history. And the sheer size of it, the super large population. If you calculate the population of China, it's 1.3 billion, close to 1.4 billion, which means almost, I checked, you know, in average European state, it made up for 14 million. So it's equivalent to 100 European states, average size. It's a continent. Super large country, vast territory, and so that kind of rise inevitably affects all of the world, given the size of China. If you look at the GDP, if it's calculated in purchasing power parity, it's already larger than the United States 3 years ago, and. If you continue with this PPP, China will be something like four or five Japans.
Why are you challenging the power of the notion of liberal democracy?
Basically, I think it's a product of European history and European civilization. In this sense, it's very regional. You want to make universal. They have to understand other cultures, other civilizations. And the Chinese one is in many ways older and continuous. For instance, this one person, one vote is never part of Chinese civilization. The Chinese civilization is always based on meritocracy. China invented the Koji system, which means you have to go through public exams and only the best can be selected and work for the government. So even today, most Chinese believe this system, what we call the selection, is better than election. Actually, we try to combine both selection plus election, and this is the China model, political model today. And furthermore, you remind me of this debate happened exactly 6 years ago, this time 6 years ago. At that time, this Arab Spring was sweeping North Africa, Middle East, and Fukuyama said that China may also experience this Arab Spring. And I said, no chance. I said, I predicted accurately. I said, Arab Spring will become Arab Winter. Yeah. I made this forecast 6 years ago. I'm perhaps the first scholar who made this prediction. But I know this week, I've been to this part of the world many times. I feel this idealized Western democracy can take roots in that part of the world. Actually, it's very difficult. The Chinese philosophy is based on what's called seeking truth from facts. You go to the field and you make investigation. You find that if there is really one person who vote, you have elect Islamic government. For sure. I'm not saying it's good or bad, simply it will be the case if you have this field visit, if you're part of the people. That's the reality. And I also made another prediction in my debate with him. I said, the US political system, liberal democracy, American style, is actually what I call a product of pre-industrial age. It has to be updated. Go through substantial reforms. the China system, political system, has been going through small, minor reforms all the time. And I made this prediction. I said, my concern is your next presidents will be worse off than George W. Bush. Most Americans may agree with my view now. No, this kind of you call European mentality or political cultural traditions is, of course, I understand very well. And sometimes you have this phrase called the state is a necessary evil. So you have to do everything to check the state, otherwise you're doing a lot of bad things. China is different because of its own political cultural traditions. If I have to paraphrase, there will be something like the state is a necessary virtue. For ordinary Chinese, inconceivable if the state disappears. Why? The China from early on, say the country was first unified in 221 BC, 2020 years ago, China, since then, was the most of the time, was a big power, a united country. And why this tradition of strong central government is prevalent in China? It had to do with this geography as well, because in China's long history, major concern for most Chinese were the flooding of the Yangtze River and the Yellow River. In order to beat this flooding, to help the victims, you know, to somehow make the two rivers work for the people rather than against people, you have to have the coordination from the central government. Not a single province or smaller state or city can do it. It must be the work of coordination. So that's why you have over thousand years you shape this long tradition of respecting the central government. And even today, as I said, China's civilization is state. It's made up of hundreds of states into one with its long history. Without a strong central government, the country disintegrates. And then people suffer because so many connections with a long history, economic, political, social, cultural, will be disorganized, will be disconnected. That will be a nightmare for most Chinese. So it's different in many ways, but to do with the size of the country and with this political tradition, cultural tradition from respective cultures, China and Europe.
But if I may, many people in your country suffered also when Mao was presiding over this country. And one of, again, the European lessons with our own forms of totalitarian absolute power is you always have to have, you know, checks and balances to control power. So again, what's your take on how political power can be controlled?
Actually, we have a lot of institutions built, even in the past and now as well. For instance, we have, like in the West, term limit, maximum two terms for top leaders. We have age limit, which is something many Western countries don't have. We have a collective leadership. The Party Central Committee at the level of political bureau is a collective leadership. And so you can't conceive, you know, say, a situation in which George W. Bush could launch two wars, civil wars, that would not happen in the Chinese political structure. And also over China's long past, we have developed this system, what we call the meritocracy. You know, we have to work through different stages of official, from the county level, provincial level, and central level. And so the respect for the state power had to do with this respect for the level, the ladder that goes through, and your past performances by stages. And then today, as you may know, we are going through this anti-corruption campaign in massive scale. And in China today, there is the mobile phone is available with everyone's smartphones. With one button, you can report any event directly to the Central Disciplinary Commission. It's called a one-button anti-corruption. You can do it right now if you see somebody, an official, you know, having a big banquet for his whatever relatives, which is against party rule, you can report right away. So all kinds of ways. You just look at the websites in China today, in Chinese web world. And criticisms of the
amphibians of the government. It's the Chinese people who control.
A lot of actually Chinese power, state power today at least, is the one of very few in the world that use a lot of opinion surveys. China's largest opinion survey organizations, institutions, their largest clients are all Chinese government at different levels. For each promotion of a local official, they will check through public opinion surveys whether you have done well or not before you can get promoted. What we call this consultative democracy.